Good morning. Oh, it's a privilege to be here with you guys this morning. My apologies. This is my first visit to the North Shore. Now, I've only been here a year, actually over a year now, so I'm no longer the new guy at Harvest, but I've been serving as the campus pastor in Crystal Lake since June of last summer. My wife Amy and I are so glad to be a part of the Harvest family, and I'll share a little bit more about our story and our journey kind of throughout the message this morning. So let's just jump right on in. Go ahead and grab your Bibles or open your phones. You want to be following along for sure this morning. We're going to continue our story, 1 Kings 19, of Elijah. As you're turning there, I want to tell you a story. When I was 11 years old, I started a forest fire. Now, let me clarify, because you probably automatically went to like those ones you see on the news. I didn't start one of those. I should say I started a forest on fire. I was walking home from baseball practice, found a pack of matches. I used to live about 2-3 miles from the baseball field, and in the 70s, we could walk places and not people weren't concerned so much. And I'm walking home, and I'm coming through these woods that are up over the hill from my backyard, and ooh, matches, right? And you're 11, and you're curious, and matches, right? And so I just start playing with them, and some of the leaves start to catch, and I'm trying to put it out, but it seems to be spreading faster than I can put it out. I start trying to find handfuls of dirt and put it out. I can't find anything. And now it's bigger. It's bigger than I can do with dirt. So I run. There's a house about 50 feet away. I see if there's a garden hose. There's a garden hose. It doesn't reach. I'm trying to spray it from afar. It's doing nothing. It's now, probably half the size of this room. I'm running to the front of this house. I am banging. I'm 11 years old. At this point, I'm crying. I'm banging on the door. I'm screaming. Like two words you would think an adult would respond to. Fire and help. Right, you hear a kid yelling those, you're probably, hopefully we're running to that. Nobody comes to the door. I run out into the street. I am screaming. Wait, like, if you saw an 11-year-old on the road, wouldn't you pull over? Nobody. They're just driving by. Like, they're driving by. And so I go to the backyard, and I'm like, and now it's as big as, it's probably spread about as far as the building floor print right here in this part. I have no idea what to do. Do I run? I don't know. I was so overwhelmed. I'm so really just fearful of what I've caused and what I've done and what's going to happen when I get home. I just sat on the ground and wept. And then I felt this hand on my shoulder. And it was the woman who had lived in the house. She had heard me banging on the door. She had looked at her back window and seen the fire now in her backyard. And instead of coming to the door, hurried and called the fire department. And she came to reassure me. And I just kept uttering this phrase. She's like, it's going to be okay. I'm like, you don't understand. My dad's going to kill me. And it was just that. It wasn't, my dad never beat me, he never hit me, but there was such fear to go home and see my dad. What I had just done would be such a disappointment to him. I'd let him down in such a horrible way. And then it got briefly worse. She's like, don't worry, the fire department's coming. They're going to be here. Okay, great. The fire department gets there. They're putting it out. I'm watching. And the chief comes over and says, okay, I want to take you home. And I'm like, what? Yeah, I'm going to drive you home. And I'm thinking, this guy is going to just make sure my dad knows what a bad kid I am. And I lit this fire. So my fear level just skyrockets. My dad is going to be so disappointed in me. Well, fortunately, that's not the way it ended out. He drives me home, and I'm scared to death. We get in the driveway. We go up to the front door. He rings the doorbell. My older brother, Jay, answers the door. And I'd been in trouble a lot. You got to understand, Jay was the good kid, I was the bad kid. And so the door opens, and there's Jay, and he looks at me, and he looks at the fire chief with his helmet on, and he looks back at me, and he just grins ear to ear. He is smiling, like, this is the, John's going to get it today. Hey, Dad, door's for you, Mom, come on down, fire chief's here. Make sure he tells him that. And the fire chief proceeds to look at my parents and say, listen, I want to let you know what happened. There was a little fire over the hill. Gives all the details and says, you should be proud of your son. I was like, even my brother was like, what? It's like every other 11-year-old kid I know would have ran. And according to the woman who lived there, John was trying to put it out with his hands, trying to put it out with a hose, trying to wave down cars. He stayed. Every other 11-year-old kid would have ran. So fortunately, the story ended well. I even got to stay home the next day. My parents felt so bad for me. But I'll never forget that moment of just, I let my dad down. I blew it, and I just don't want to see him. I was so scared to see him because I had blown it so badly. You ever feel that way? You ever have a moment in a relationship? Maybe it was a marriage. Maybe it was a friendship. Maybe it was the same with you and a parent or a coach or an authority figure. You blew it so bad, you just didn't even want to see him. You ever felt that way with God? You ever felt that with God where you blew it so badly or you were so discouraged or you had doubted him so much? Maybe this week, in light of the events of this week, you're looking at this going, God, what are you doing? How could you let this happen? And you just really don't want to see him because you're so overwhelmed with discouragement, overwhelmed with anxiety, overwhelmed with fear. And you just don't want to see him. You're afraid to be in his presence. Well, Elijah has one of these moments. And I want to learn from his story today because the way that God responds to his overwhelming discouragement, and in his discouragement, he makes bad choices. He takes it even further and really to the point of failing in the moment. But God's continued response is one of the most beautiful pictures that we have, I think, of how God deals with us when we are discouraged, when we feel like giving up, when we feel like quitting, when we feel like we've let him down so badly, we don't even want to see him. And so my hope, if you haven't already been encouraged by this morning, through the worship, through your scripture reading, by the way, thank you for that, folks. I'm encouraged by the passages that you read this morning. I hope even more so through this message you'll be encouraged in Elijah's story here this morning. So let's look at 1 Kings 19. Let's not forget, right? He just defeated the prophets of Baal. If you heard last week's message, to me, one of the coolest stories in the Old Testament. I love reading it. What a powerful display of God. Like, if I'm Elijah at this point, I'm walking around thinking, like, go ahead and make my day. What are you going to do? Nothing can stop me. Look what just happened. Even Ahab, his arch nemesis, right, seems to be complacent. At the end of that story, right, Elijah looked at him and said, hey, listen, it's finally going to rain because I told you it's going to rain again. Go home, get home, and okay, whatever. Like, he just listens to whatever he has to say. Everything is going Elijah's way. And then we come to chapter 19, verse 1. Follow along with me. Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so may the gods do to me and more also if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by this time tomorrow. Then he was afraid and he arose and he ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and then he left his servant there. Things just took a pretty sharp turn in his life. Like, if I'm Elijah, I'm thinking Ahab seems to be a little bit more complacent. I think Jezebel will finally shut her mouth. Look at what God did. No, she makes a declaration. May the gods actually do to me what you did, what God did on the mountain tomorrow if I haven't killed you yet. Basically, I'm going to kill you. And if I don't kill you by tomorrow, may the gods kill me and more. I don't get the and more part. I don't think you can do more than being killed. But a death threat, a death sentence. Ahab, I think, talk about a letdown. Talk about becoming overwhelmed. Talk about, hey, God, what are you doing? Like, God, we just did this thing, right? We're winning. We're winning. Isn't it time to maybe set her straight? If she's the last one left, all we got to do is set her straight. We're probably going to win this thing. But all we're told is he was afraid and he ran. We get into these moments of discouragement. And fear might start to manifest itself. Doubt might start to manifest itself. Despair might start to manifest itself. And we have a choice. We can run into that, not a good idea, as we'll see today. Or we can run away from it. We can run back to God. We see no evidence of that. Elijah is afraid, and it says he ran. He arose, and he ran for his life. He, in fact, ran 100 miles. Right? He was in Jezreel, and then he ran all the way to Beersheba. Probably took him 7 days. He was that afraid, right? Imagine what it would, 7 days travel from here. That's how far he went. You can't get that far in the continental U.S. in a car. You're in California in 3 to 4, probably. If you're afraid, you're probably there even in 2. So the equivalent of 7 days, I don't even know how far, but that's how far he went. Huge letdown. Huge letdown. We sometimes put these expectations on God and he doesn't meet them, but it's because our expectations maybe were wrong, or maybe we misunderstood how he's working even now to look at the events of this past week. God, what are you doing? I don't understand it, God. That never happened so close to my home. It never happened in my backyard before. I don't get it. You know, for me, one of the biggest letdowns I've ever faced was just 2 years ago. Most of you probably don't know our story. So my wife, Amy, and I were in Arizona. I was pastoring a small church, and we had decided we wanted to transition that church to become a Harvest. Back in 2013. I had known about Harvest. I had grown up here originally. I'd known a lot about Harvest and loved the DNA of Harvest Bible Chapel, and we wanted to be a Harvest. But the church we had been pastoring had been a very hard season of ministry, and I needed to heal for a season. So we kind of told the launch team, listen, we're staying here. We're not going anywhere, but we need to find somebody else to be the pastor for this season. So in 2014, we relaunched that church, Harvest Bible Chapel, Fountain Hills. Small town right next to Scottsdale. If you've ever been to Phoenix, most people know where Scottsdale is. We're just up into the foothills, so it's the most beautiful part of the valley. John will disagree with me, but he's wrong. And 2 years later, the Lord had done a lot of work in my life and said, hey, I'm not done with you. It's time to get back into ministry. My wife and my kids and I had the privilege of coming to the Harvest Training Center in 2016. One of the best 4 months of our lives as a family. We were so blessed here, that church training center that Harvest used to put on. We were built up, all four of us. We all grew like a weed for that 4 months that we were here. My wife and I were convinced this is going to be our final church. There was a phrase they kept using in the training center, like, hey, guys, why don't you think one church, one wife, one life. Try to make wherever you're going your last church. And that was our plan. We're going back to Fountain Hills. We loved it there. We love the people there. God, we're gonna grow and die there and hand this church off to some young guy when I'm too old to preach. I finally got to be the lead pastor, which I had felt called to do. I'm standing here today because we closed that church 2 years ago. Biggest letdown in my life. When COVID hit, for some reason, it hit our church really, really hard. And we just saw people continue, even in the first 2 months, before anybody else had even opened yet, church-wise, people just leaving, sending us texts, sending us emails, giving us calls, calling me for coffee. Hey, Pastor, we're going to move on from Harvest. Where are you going? Well, we don't know. Nobody's open right now. And in the fall of 2020, our elders voted to close the church. It was the right decision, and I knew that at the time, but it was devastating to us. We're probably leaving Arizona, which we absolutely loved. I've got to start over again and build new friends again. My wife's going to have to find another job, and she was teaching at the university level out there, and she absolutely loved it. Our kids were in college. Where are we going to end up? How are we going to pay these bills? And again, as the lead pastor sitting there thinking, this is my fault, by the way. Satan came after me for weeks and months of that. You're the failure. You're the reason this church would have worked under any other pastor, John. Huge letdown. We've all been there. We've all had this kind of a letdown in our life that it leads to fear, it leads to doubt, it leads to discouragement, it leads to feeling like you failed, and maybe you even did fail. The question is, what are we going to do with that? Elijah didn't talk to God. No evidence that he talked to God. He was afraid. He got up and he ran 100 miles. I'm telling you now, hear me in the beginning of this. Don't run away from God. Run to God in your fear and your discouragement. But either way, he's going to do what he does with Elijah to us. So let's continue with this. Verse 4, Elijah's not done. He says this, or the text tells this, but he himself, right, he'd left his servant, there it says, ran 100 miles, left his servant, so now he's alone. He himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree. And he asked that he might die, saying, it is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I'm no better than my father's. So he just ran 100 miles to save his life, and now he wants to die. Something happened. I think the key is in that phrase, I'm no better than my father's. He's not talking about his dad or his grandpa. He's talking about the other prophets of God who've gone before him, who were faithful. And he sees in this moment how unfaithful he's being. He's failed in his faith in this moment. He's not lost. He's not no longer a child of God. But in this moment, he's failed. He's run away from God. He sees himself as no better. Well, I tried to defeat the prophets of Baal. We should have defeated, but Jezebel's still there. We've lost. I can't do it. I must not be good enough. Whatever it is, he feels like an utter failure. He's lost hope. He's moved from fear, I believe, to utter despair. Lord, I just want to die. Just let me die. Maybe some of us can relate. Maybe not going that far to wanting to die, but that place of despair, that place of hopelessness, the place of, God, I'm such a failure. That's where he is. So I can now understand why he went from running to save his life to wanting to just die, because he felt like such a failure. That's what letdown can do to us. That's what being alone can do to us as well, by the way. He's in a place of fear and despair and hopelessness. He ran away from God towards his fear instead of toward God, towards God. So when we have these moments in our lives, and my guess is maybe some of us are there right now because of the events of this past week. Maybe you're there because of something else that went on in your life. Maybe there's some health challenges. Maybe there's some work challenges. Maybe you've just been in a season of rebellion and you've somehow given in to these different emotions and run away from God. The beauty is that whatever you've done, whatever I've done, whatever Elijah did, God is still faithful. Hear me on that. When we are in those moments when we are faithless, God is still abundantly faithful. And this is how he treats us, by the way. When we are in these moments of discouragement, these seasons of doubt, these seasons of despair and hopelessness, maybe it's a season when we've actually failed the Lord, whatever it is, this is how he treats us. Three things we're going to learn today. First one is this: he sustains us. Look back at the text with me. He sustains us. Verse 5. There it is. And he lay down and slept under a bruise. No, is that 4? No, I didn't read that. All right, I'm rereading. He lay down and slept under a broom tree, and behold, an angel touched him and said to him, "Arise and eat." And he looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate, and he drank, and he lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, "Arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you." And he rose, and he ate and drank, and went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mount of God. So Elijah ran away. God decides to come and be with him. Not that God ever left him, right? But God decides to show up. I don't know about you, but when I do something wrong for the Lord, when I kind of blow it, however small or big, I kind of feel like the Lord's just waiting to pounce. I don't know if I'm the only one that feels that way, but even on our vacation this past week, I won't go into detail, some pretty significant stomach problems one day. So we could do nothing that day of vacation. I laid in bed the whole day. And for the briefest of moment, I'm like, what did I do wrong? I must have done something wrong. I have this warped view sometimes that God is so quick to punish, and yet here it's the exact opposite. God doesn't shake him awake and say, "Hey, what are you doing? What are you afraid of? I'm still God." He doesn't reprimand him. He doesn't scold him. He lets him rest. He lies down under this broom tree, and God just lets him rest. God comes and sustains him, right? He lets him rest. He needed rest. He'd just run 115 miles. And then, by the way, he provides food and water. And this time he doesn't do it by the ravens. He's still the God of the ravens, but this time he sends an angel. Imagine taking a nap in your season of discouragement. If you've been discouraged this whole week, you've been battling doubt this whole week, and you go home and you take a nap and you wake up and there's an angel standing there. "Hey, God, this is from God for you." It's going to change my perspective on things. He just goes back to sleep. God doesn't get mad, doesn't get angry. He wakes him up a little longer later, lets him rest again. He's sustaining him. He's helping him find his strength again, helping him get the right perspective, hopefully, again. And again, he wakes him to give him the food and the water. God just graciously allows him to rest, graciously provides food and water. And then we're told he's going to go on another journey, 40 days to 40 nights to Mount Horeb, to Mount Sinai. It's another 200 miles. And this isn't God telling him to go. This is the angel simply affirming, "We know where you're going. You need some more food because you're going here." God's not telling him to go, but they know that he's going and they give him food to sustain him. In fact, it says in verse 8, right? He went in the strength of that food for 40 days. Some scholars would say this was an absolute fast, that he ate that last meal, and then for 40 days he went in the strength of that food. Might be the case. We're not told that word for word, so I'm not going to say for sure it is, but either way, God sustains him for 40 days. Whether God gave him the strength to go on an absolute fast or God gave him food every day, God sustained him every day. Elijah needed more time alone, more time to heal, more time to understand. He needed rest. He needed food, and so God did it all. You know, for Amy and I, one of the beautiful things, many of the beautiful things that have come out of our church closing in Arizona. So January of 2021, we had our last official service. I just started looking for a new job. And I've been through this process before, and if any of you have ever been on a search committee with a church, you know it's usually 6 to 12 months on average, but usually closer to the 12 to 18 months when you're looking for a new pastor. And you just watched it with a new lead pastor. It took more than that. takes time. And so even as the pastor applying, I'm like, okay, I got 6 to 12 months, probably 12 to 18 months. I'm currently unemployed. I have two kids in college. That's not going to go well. Our church was able to give us about 3 months worth of severance with what money was left and the things we were able to sell. They were able to give us 3 months, which was a wonderful gift. But there were what would be the end of the story was from the closing to here was 6 months. And we didn't accumulate one penny of debt. We paid every college bill, every college loan. We just watched in that season as God sustained us. For us, it was a financial need. And we just sat there going, God, we don't know what you're going to do. You know our needs. We're trusting you. We're going to just sit and rest and trust you. And then a check came from a church in town that knew me really well for a few thousand dollars. And then a check from a friend came in the mail. And another check from another church and another check from another friend. And the Lord just provided every penny we needed. So in all honesty, from the day we closed to the day I got my first paycheck here at Harvest, it's like we never missed a payday. And all of our kids' bills were paid for school. And we were able to get a house here in Algonquin. And here we are. This is what God does. Throughout Scripture, this is what he does. Sometimes it is supernatural, right? Exodus 34, talking about Moses. Moses was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He neither ate bread or drank water. He did do an absolute fast. Don't ever do that unless the Lord tells you. You won't make it. But the Lord sustains us in so many different ways. It's not always about food and water. It could be about a financial sustaining. It could be about strength and hope and peace and joy. But this is what he does for us. Even right now, if you're in that season of discouragement and doubt, this is what he's doing for you. And I hope you see it. Look for it because he's doing it. And I would say, unlike Elijah, who just kind of went back to sleep and doesn't really ever say thank you, acknowledge what the Lord is doing for you and let it steer you back to him instead of like Elijah who ran another 200 miles further into the desert. God is faithful. When everything else might fail around you, when maybe you were the one that failed, God is faithful and he will sustain you and is sustaining you and give you whatever you need for whatever season or time you're in. The second thing he does to us is this. He speaks to us. Let's go back to the text, verse 9. There he came to a cave and lodged in it. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. And he said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I've been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel. For the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left. And they seek my life to take it away. And he said, go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountain, and broken pieces, the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak, and he went out and stood at the entrance to the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? I love the beginning, right? He came to this cave and says, the word of the Lord came to him. God didn't come and yell at him. Right? I remember thinking I was going to get brought home by that fire chief, and my dad was just going to yell. My mom was just going to yell. I was going to probably be sent to my room for a year and all kinds of punishment. They were just going to yell. They were so angry. God does none of that. Elijah's run 300 miles away from the Lord, away from everything. God doesn't yell at him. He doesn't reprimand him. He asks him a question. What a beautiful picture of grace. He doesn't lecture him, right? Remember again, the first time, all the way back in chapter 17, the first time he ran away from Ahab. Ahab wanted to kill him. Chapter 17, verse 3, this is God speaking, depart from here and turn eastward and hide yourself by the brook Cherith, which is east of the Jordan. This is when the Lord provided by the ravens. God told him to do all of this, but not this time. But God doesn't correct or reprimand. He just simply asks him a question. He's trying to help him heal. He's trying to help him understand. He's trying to help him process everything that's gone on. He's trying to help Elijah get through his emotions, get through his thoughts, and get back to where he's supposed to be. So he comes with a gentle question. The question's pretty direct as well. It's gentle, it's gracious, but it is also a correction. He's helping Elijah to see, you're not supposed to be here. But he doesn't say that. He doesn't point any of that out. He just says, what are you doing here? Why have you come all this way? What beautiful grace. But Elijah doesn't hear it. Look back at the text. Look at verse 10. Right, his long response to the question in verse 10. And right in the middle, you have it, right? First, I'll read the whole thing again. He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword, and I only am left. Well, that's a lot about him, isn't it? He actually doesn't answer the question, does he? What are you doing here? Well, I ran away because I was afraid. God's trying to get him just to be honest. Because when we're not honest with the Lord, who suffers? Us, not him. All Elijah had to say was, God, I'm afraid. This woman wants to kill me. She has the power. She's the queen. I'm afraid, so I ran. That's the right answer. Instead, he makes an excuse. How often do we do that? Things aren't going right. We feel discouraged. We feel overwhelmed. So we make an excuse as to why we're behaving poorly. Why we're giving into our doubt. Why we're giving into our fear. God, I'm the only one who would stand up for you. And now they want to kill me. I'm the only one, God. I'm the only one. Is there maybe a hint of him even saying, hey, God, I'm fighting. Where are you? I don't know. Maybe not. But there seems to be that he's moved from this place of fear, maybe to despair and hopelessness, now almost to a place of pride and bitterness. He's missing out on all that God has already done for him. He's forgetting all of the miraculous things God has done. God, if anybody, right, God could have said, hey, Elijah, with your rant about how you're the only one fighting for me, do you remember what I did, Elijah? Do you remember when Ahab wanted to kill you the first time? I sent you out into the desert. I provided to the ravens. Hey, do you remember when there was no food in the place and I raised up a widow to help care for you? Oh, and when her son died, do you remember what I did through you? I raised that kid back to life. Oh, and you remember what I did to those prophets of Baal? He could have come back with that response and he would have been justified. You want to play the I game? Look what I am did, Elijah. But he doesn't. What a beautiful picture of grace. If you're like me and you maybe perceive God as this person quick to discipline, quick to punish, who almost gets joy out of it. And I hope you can break free from that today, because again, it's something I've struggled with my whole life. And to see God as the gracious, faithful God that he is, who asks him a question. No big reprimand, just grace and care and his presence. If you're in that place right now, that's what God is doing. He's pouring his grace on you. He's caring for you more than you know, and he is with you. This is what he does. This is who he is. You know, as I was reading this story over and over this week, I kept also thinking in the New Testament, Jesus does the same thing with Peter. If you go to John 21, right, verse 15, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? He doesn't show up on the scene and say, Peter, I told you so. I told you were going to deny me. What are you going to say for yourself, Peter? Like, seriously, you saw me there suffering and you denied me? He just shows up on scene, provides breakfast, right? He provides breakfast for Peter and the disciples. Hey, come sit around a meal with me. What is it? Oh, is he sustaining maybe again? And then he speaks again. Hey, Peter, I just got a question for you. Just trying to get Peter to answer and Peter to heal. Peter to forgive himself, really. Forgiveness of God is free, but Peter needed to forgive himself. Elijah needed to forgive himself. Do we maybe need to forgive ourselves sometimes for giving into that doubt and running to that fear and running with that discouragement? We feel worse about it, and we need to forgive ourselves because God's forgiven us. We need to just come back and rest in his presence, rest as he sustains us, rest as he speaks to us and listen. Can you remember a time in the past when maybe you've run away from the Lord? How has he sustained you in the past? How has he spoken to you in the past to get you back right where you are now? Does anything come to mind? I hope a whole bunch of things start just pouring into your mind. And I don't say that because, you know, you're a bunch of sinners and you run, but I'm a sinner and I run too. Like, that's been a privilege of working on this message, is remembering the times. God's abundant patience and grace and faithfulness just kept bringing me back and bringing me back. Because unfortunately, I ran the wrong way, away from him instead of to him. Guys, in his faithfulness, God is speaking graciously to us right now, trying to bring healing and guidance, comfort, and so much more. Are you listening? I hope so. I don't think Elijah was, by the way. But I hope you are. I hope I am. I hope we are listening. Look back at it. Here's the next thing that he does, by the way, the final step. He sustains us, he speaks with us, and he sends us. The last part of the passage, verse 15, says such tiny print. I got to get bigger glasses. Oh, sorry, wait, verse 14, I misread my own notes. Here we go. He's right. God just asked him the second time, what are you doing here? He said, I've been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Sound familiar? Any word changed at all? No. Unfortunately, I don't think he's really truly listening. He hears the word, but he's not really listening to what the Lord's trying to help him with. But again, God in his graciousness doesn't reprimand him, doesn't correct him and try to bring him down off his high horse. This is what I love he does. And the Lord said to him, go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to the death. And the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to the death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him. Again, God doesn't yell, God doesn't reprimand. God in his grace and wisdom realizes Elijah just kind of needs maybe a little bit more of a kick in the butt. I'm just going to call him back into ministry, which is what he wants for all of us. When we run away, God just wants to restore us to a right relationship with him, to being back on mission, right? Every one of us is full-time in ministry. Every one of us is on mission or should be. And he's just trying to get Elijah back to where he belonged. And in his grace, he's like, you know what? Elijah may not fully get it yet, and maybe he needs to get it on the journey back. And so I'm just going to call him now. He restores him. He sends him back into ministry. Elijah never apologized in those responses. Never did he not only just own up to his fear, he also never apologized for his horrible behavior throughout. Never said, thank you, none of that. But God in his grace and faithfulness restores him anyway. He doesn't punish him, he restores him. In fact, he promises to help him raise up others. And maybe this was the thing that finally got Elijah over the hump. I think that maybe in this last little bit of God talking is where Elijah finally did heal. Finally did maybe his eyes suddenly came off himself. When God said, hey, by the way, I'm going to raise up others. Two kings, by the way. There's two kings, and you're going to raise up another guy named Elisha to come after you. And together, the four of you, over the next chunk of years, we're going to win this battle. This battle that you were so discouraged about. We are going to win it. We are going to wipe out the prophets of Baal completely. Jezebel will be gone someday. You won't be here to do it still, but we will win this battle together. You're not alone. Right? His biggest issue was he was alone. Hey, there's going to be another prophet right there with you, a mentor traveling with you even. These two other kings, and we're going to do it. Oh, and oh, by the way, there's 7,000 more Jewish men and women who've never bowed. You're not alone. I love the way our God reacts. Not condemnation, but grace and encouragement. We're discouraged. God is trying to encourage us and remind us of all the things that we have. I think Elijah's biggest problem was that he ran alone. Folks, I watch it all the time. Christians get into a season of discouragement, a season of despair and hopelessness. Stop attending small group for a while. And then they stop attending Sunday morning. And it just gets worse and worse and worse because they're alone. The gift that you have here, I'm sure you know it already. The gift we have in each one of our campuses, having a church family to speak into our lives, to not let us run to fear. But when our brothers and sisters find us running to fear, to stop us and grab us and shake and say, hey, man, no, I'm not going to let you because I love you. I'm going to sit here and pray with you. I'm going to sit here and help you and encourage you and love you. But I'm not going to let you run to fear. I'm not going to let you run to discouragement. But we help each other get out of it. What a beautiful gift we have. But God does this beautiful picture, promises him all these things, but Elijah still has a choice. And this is why I believe that finally in this moment, even though we're not told, I think Elijah's heart began to heal. Because after just having said for the second time, I, God, I would think, wait, you want me to go back? You want me to go back? Did you hear what I just said? They want to kill me. You want me to go back? I would have thought he'd quit. That's an option, right? My church closed in Arizona. That was an option. You know what, Lord? This was too hard. I'm done. I don't know how many pastors will tell you there's probably at least one moment in their season of ministry that they've had that they've thought about quitting. Many do. I'm sure it crossed Elijah's mind, but he didn't, folks. You'll hear more about that next week, but he didn't quit. He went back 300 miles. He found Elisha and raised him up. Elisha would raise up these kings, and the work would continue. This is what our great and amazing God does for us. Just like Elijah had a choice, so do we. We have a choice as you sit here today. Wherever you sit, you have a choice. Something to remember, too, God doesn't need us. And I don't say that to judge any one of us. He doesn't. If I had quit and stepped out of ministry, somebody else would be standing here today. If Elijah didn't go back, Elisha probably would have been raised up like that by the Lord. Just as Elijah was raised up by the Lord and all the other prophets were. But he chooses to use us. We get to go for the Lord. We get to be with the Lord. And if we say no, we're the only ones who suffer and miss out. And Elijah didn't. Thank God he didn't for his sake. And thank God we don't for our sake. So where are you this morning? Are you somewhere in this story? Maybe not. Maybe you've been in a good season of faith and the events of this past week kind of even spurred you on to want to get out there and just do more for the Lord. Tell more people about Jesus. But maybe the events had the other toll on you. Or maybe, like I said earlier, there's something else going on in your life that has led you to a season of discouragement and despair and hopelessness. Where are you in this season? Where are you in this story? And what I would ask you to remember is that God is faithful. Wherever you are, if maybe you just begin to run away, you just begin to give in to the doubt or the discouragement, look for how the Lord is sustaining you. Number one, run back, but look for how he's sustaining you and lean into that. If maybe you've gotten far enough to where you've moved beyond that and now you're almost getting angry about it or you're hopeless, or you've gotten to despair, you just want to give up and quit, he is speaking. Are you listening? Trying to help process, trying to help understand. When the time comes that he wants to restore you, can I just ask you to say yes? This is the great and amazing God that we have. Folks, don't run away, run to him. Whatever maybe you've been battling, just run to him in it. Grab a friend as well. Don't leave your friend in one city and run out into the desert. Grab somebody that can help you and encourage you and run to him. And just bask in his care as he sustains you and speaks to you and eventually works to send you back out. You know, part of the beauty of my recent story, when Harvest Fountain Hills was closing, Amy actually saw the opening for the Crystal Lake position. And we both kind of laughed. Because our time at the training center was so special. We had said, man, if the Lord would ever open the door, we'd love to work there someday. I mean, we know we're going back to Arizona and we're there till the end. But if God opened the door, we love this church. Loved everything about Harvest. We had so many friends who were on staff here and attended here. We loved it. But when she saw the opening, we both kind of giggled. Partly because of the challenges y'all had faced. But a big part was, for me, what I just went through. I remember reading the job description and thinking, all right, I could do this. But I just pastored a church of 200 into the ground. Why on earth would they hire me? I didn't think anybody would, especially Harvest. They've got their own challenges going on. Why are they going to hire a guy who couldn't build a church, who couldn't keep his church open? Battled that for probably 4 to 5 weeks. And yet here I stand. Holy Spirit just kept poking me. Send in your resume. Every morning in my quiet times. But I'm a failure. I don't care. Send in your resume.
Send in your resume. Fortunately, in that season, I was listening. I wasn't running from him. I was discouraged. But I was listening. And 6 months later, we were here. And this last year has been such a gift to my wife and I, such a gift to my children. So much healing, so much love, so much grace. And we've seen God work, not just in our campus in Crystal Lake, right? As a church, we're seeing God work. He's rebuilding his bride here called Harvest. People are coming to know Christ. People are getting baptized. Marriages are being strengthened. He's doing so much, and we have so much more ahead of us. And even in this region right now, there's so much that could happen potentially. I hate it that events like those of the last week are often used, that are where God works so much, that we need those, or we don't need them, but it's where God so often uses to get our attention, folks. But the opportunity that we have, that you have especially, I can tell you right now, the Lord wants to send you if you don't feel like you're sent already. Right here, we're surrounded by those that don't know the Lord. Wherever you are, lean in. Look for how he sustains. Listen to how he speaks and say yes when he restores. And let's be a people that, like Elijah, continue to go forth on mission with him. Amen? Would you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for your goodness, for your faithfulness. You are so good to us, and you are so faithful, even when we don't see it, even when we don't recognize it, even when we turn our back on it and we run from it sometimes, you continue to remain faithful and good because that's who you are. You never turn your back on your children. You never forsake us. You never leave us. Just like with Elijah, you were there the whole time. And just as with him, you so gently cared for him and sustained him when he needed it most. How you gently spoke with him, trying to help him heal and learn and grow. And how when it was all said and done, you restored him. You sent him back out on mission. You do the same with us so graciously, so faithfully. We cannot thank you enough for what you do. Lord, like the song we sang earlier, we want to just sit, stand here as a people and say, here we are, send us. And so I just pray for us here this morning. I pray for my brothers and sisters that may be hurting, they may be leaning in too much to discouragement or despair or hopelessness or fear. God, rescue them. Show them how you're caring for them. Help them to hear your voice so they would come back to you and not run away, but run towards you. Help us to be a people that when we seem overwhelmed and we're massively let down, help us to run back to you, God, I pray. And let you heal us and let you strengthen us and let you grow us and get us back out there. And yet I also pray too, God, for this family here, this part of our Harvest family here in the North Shore, for courage and for boldness in the season as they go back out on ministry, they go out on ministry into a people around here that are hurting tremendously and who desperately need you. God, as you would move mightily through Elijah, as you would restore him and then move mightily through him once again, we pray the same here. Move mightily in us and bring healing and strength and hope, and move mightily through us in this region, for your glory, we ask and we pray. Amen.